I am Karim Nader, and I have had the pleasure to study memory in a lab that's quite well known already for its description of how the brain controls fear and emotions. And at that time, when I was in Joseph Ledoux's lab at the Center for Neuroscience, I had the opportunity to see Eric Kandel give a beautiful talk. Eric Kandel has won the Nobel Prize, deservedly, for describing a vision and an approach and then fulfilling that vision in terms of how to study memory processing. And so at that time when I saw that talk, I thought, wow, wouldn't it be beautiful? And so the typical, I think, expectation or description of memories is that when you have something new, it's initially unstable and then gets stabilized in the brain over time within a few hours. And so I showed that when you have a memory that's stored in the brain, it can get unstored, like physically kind of unwired from the brain, has to be restored. And if you think of memories as being not just entities in our identity, but in our culture, and sometimes if memories are negative things, such as pathologies, leading to PTSD, if you figure out a way of kind of erasing memories when they are being transformed back into this unstable state, then you could theoretically, I think, make people better, and the cultures around which some people have suffered and identify themselves with suffering. And perhaps if you can target those memories, that's some of the implications of targeting the memory mechanisms in the brain.
Hey there. So I'm a visual artist. My name is Shimon Attie. I have 5 minutes to do what I usually do in an hour, and which is a wonderful challenge. So I work in a variety of media. I come from photography originally. I work with multiple-channel immersive video installation, public projects. Ultimately, I suppose one would say I'm an installation artist. And I, for maybe 20 years since I got my MFA, I've been very interested in how artists or how I might be able to use contemporary media to give visual form to human memory. So this is an image, for example, from the first project I did after art school in one of Berlin's former Jewish quarters. And what you're looking at is not Photoshop, it's not montage. It's a color photograph of a building with a black and white projection of something that was photographed there in 1930, which was a Hebrew bookstore. So I would intervene on various facades in the neighborhood and create these temporary site-specific installations that would, in a sense, reanimate these sites with images of their former denizens, residents, businesses, etc. And then I would make color photographs of these images. And one of the driving forces for my work, which is something that Megan Elizabeth had asked us to address, is how does one give physical form to something that has no form? How do we give presence to absence? So this is something that's often been interest in much of my work. This is just a couple of minutes of documentation from an underwater installation that I did in Copenhagen. These are 9 very large light boxes. There's not enough time to get into the content, but they relate to human rights, two human rights challenges, one present day dealing with refugees and immigrants in Europe, and the other historical, dealing with the history of the Second World War. But in this project, with these underwater light boxes, and they're very, very large, I was, in a sense, addressing another question that nags at me in my work, which is how to represent the fragility of memory, that memory is never fixed, it's never static, and it's never complete. I think that was sort of driving part of some of the aesthetic choices that I made in this project. And we, you know, I could, if we had more time, I could linger, but I'm not going to. And last but not least, and I think I was inspired to show this project because of Julia when I read about her work and also about memory in the body, I did a project, it was a very difficult project. It was with the Welsh village of Aberfan. And it, if there are Brits in the audience, I wouldn't need to say anything more about Aberfan. But it's very well-known village in the UK because it became famous, in quotation marks, famous in 1966 when a man-made avalanche related to coal mining came down a mountainside and buried the village's only elementary school, like a Welsh Pompeii. And it was only one school in the village, so they lost their entire generation of children. About 115 kids and 25 teachers. That was the first disaster and trauma. And the second trauma is this sort of media voyeurism that has descended upon the village ever since. It became famous as the village that lost its children, because it's kind of an epic scale of disaster. And they have felt that on the receiving end of meat of what's the expression, rubbernecking and disaster tourism ever since. So I worked with members. I lived in the village for 6 months, and this was on the occasion of the 40-year anniversary. And I had them perform being themselves, playing their role in the village. There's no actors. There's no digital effects. They are literally holding still on a revolving plinth. And she's the dancer of the village. She sees herself as the dancer. The villagers see her as the dancer. And I filmed about 35 different characters of the village. Again, I could go a little bit more into the project if there was more time, but my main point here is that part of why I use this strategy around trauma is that, in a traumatized landscape, is that it was my way to reflect how we respond to trauma, that we freeze, in part, but it's always an incomplete freeze because the forces of life keep moving forward. So this kind of moving stillness is what I was trying to give voice to. This is just a dumbed down viewing copy. They're actually, it's a 5-channel installation. They're projected larger than life size in high definition. And the other thing is I wanted to give visual expression to that sense of voyeurism, being in a fishbowl with the world looking in. The villagers feel forever fixed by the world's gaze and their association of the disaster, of the village with the disaster 40 years ago. So I think that will do it.
What you're looking at is Michelle Buckley, who's a dancer I work with regularly and who has been subject to many experiments that may have felt, she may have felt compromised her ability to dance the way she would like to. Performing what ended up, in this performance it may be somewhat less, but in the end, 301 digits past the decimal place of pi. And, you know, the memorization of pi is a much favored activity of many nerds and geeks, myself included. Let me turn this down. This was part of a program called the Brodmann Areas, which was this guy Brodmann mapped the cerebral cortex. And so I investigated the cerebral cortex, and obviously, of course, one of the things that came up was memory. And so I had several experiments, we called them experiments, involving memory. Of course, they became performances. Let me get rid of that. So, you know, the memorization of pi, one of my role models was this guy, John Horton Conway. I think he's a professor at Princeton right now. And he used this sound-based mnemonics to divide up the digits of pi, because the whole issue here was in memorization, to get it into long-term memory, you have to have some sort of storage or encoding device to keep it there. And so I thought, you know, how can we create an encoding device and then stress the dancer so much that she can't make it through all the digits, even though she's learned them or studied them? So we used some phrasing, but the way we devised the movement is that each digit had a particular movement quality or action. Maybe it came from a particular joint. She has one we called leg butt and another one we called butt leg. Zero was facing forward. I think that was zero right there. But of course, the context of each of the digits would be different because she would be in a different place and position as each digit came. The result of this was that it truly was apparent that pi is an irrational number. There are no repeating digits anywhere. I mean, there are times when you have a 2-2, but there is no pattern that she could ever latch on to. So, after finding out that I was coming here to talk to you tonight, I met with Michelle this week on Monday, and I asked Michelle to bring her shoes and her pie outfit. We were going to take some pictures, and she said, "Oh, good, I'll practice pie for you, Julia." And I said, "No," and of course she wrote back and said, "I knew you'd say that," because during the performance of Pi backstage, I had to keep telling her to stop rehearsing. I didn't want her to rehearse. I really wanted to challenge her memory, and I really wanted it to fail. So we got together, and I didn't know really what to expect, but we started out, and she remembered 7 digits past the decimal point, which is, I think that's the short-term memory number, is that right? 7 elements? So...
It is. Yeah. It's exactly how many elements you can keep in mind at a time without any kind of distraction.
Yeah. So she remembered 7, clearly 7, and then I sat there and I didn't talk to her and I let her struggle, and she tried and tried, and she came up with some of the movements she remembered, and then she started to piece little bits together, and she managed with a little help to come up with a phrase that was fairly long, maybe 13 digits or so, but after that always needed prodding. And I just thought that it was an incredible example of, first of all, the difficulty in memorizing beyond a certain point, the failure of the long-term memory. If she hasn't done this for 8 months, and it was essentially gone. I'd thought that we'd put it into muscle memory, that she would, that it would still be there somehow. And I think it is, but it was there with prodding. If we could find a moment that she knew, then she could derive some of the movements that came after through the process of knowing where she was, because of the feeling of a movement. I want to just tell you what she said. She said, "There's no other challenge of any ballet repertoire can match the process of performing Pi." She said, "When I watch myself doing Pi," she's still going, by the way, and she had to overlap with the next segments in the ballet because I wanted her to keep going until it was done, which was partly the representation of just how far she would go. She's very determined. She says, "When I watch myself doing Pi, it's a completely different person. I feel no connection with any other experiences in my life, and I don't," and she said that she feels disconnected from it because she doesn't, she can't really, she can sort of predict the movement, but the numbers aren't really in her. And she said it was a very different nervous kind of experience, that before performing, she didn't really have any nerves. And I think that was because the focus had to be such a major part of her process of going through this. The last thing I want to say, perfect, is that, you know, when I think about memory and dance, you know, we do memory. It's, you know, as an artist, yeah, we think about, you know, maybe creating memories, but we do memory. We do memory every single day, every single class. One of the things you do in a technique class is you learn new material and you have to memorize it through whatever systems, mnemonic systems, rehearsal, chunking, whatever you're going to do, and you have to perform it. And the best dancers are the ones who do that the most quickly. But it just occurs to me that we use sort of 3 ways of memorizing, and I watched her do this. So there's visuals, so she would try to, you could see her kind of seeing the movement but not being able to put it together. There was no real audio component. She didn't have anything to latch onto in terms of music. There was a spatial component, so sometimes she would know that, oh wait, I was up here in space, and that maybe would trigger some numbers. But also what studio we were in. If I had brought her back to this space, I think she would have remembered more. And unfortunately, her kinesthetic memory wasn't really strong here because nothing really flowed the movement was a little bit awkward. The patterns were difficult to memorize in her body. And lastly, you know, we often use imagery, but I avoided using any sort of imagery because I wanted it to be about memorizing numbers. So we didn't let her go into other areas of her sort of process of memorizing. I think that about covers it. And you've seen she's finished now.
You know, part of me keeps thinking when we're talking about it is that memory can perhaps, or more than perhaps, has been proven to be able to be malleable and change as it's reconsolidated. But that, of course, doesn't mean it inevitably will, right? It sometimes has that potential because of the experience memory sometimes harden over time rather than become elastic.
Exactly. Yeah, and that's a great point because if you think of reconsolidation as a way of updating your views on life and a culture being the sum of people's views on an incident, then reconsolidation updating people's perception of an event could kind of change culturally the value of something in their history and their narrative. And so that's one way. So reconsolidation is one way by which the value and the cultural representation of some events could change, but some things do not undergo reconsolidation, as you said. And therefore, you know, you would hope that some things would be so robust in somebody's culture, you know, the value of that is just going to be static.
Right, right.
But again, it's still an open question. And many societies that have a kind of a narrative passing of their history. So every time it's said and then the memory is reactivated, then it's possible for that information to be changed and then updated in ways that, you know, would suggest that maybe the latest generation of people would have the greatest input on that.
Right. It makes me think about cognitive dissonance, because I mean, in the sense that maybe memory works, you know, maybe memory at times can also be the slave of cognitive dissonance, meaning that we sometimes will keep re-encoding memories in a certain way to conform to certain ideologies or beliefs.
Absolutely.
Or opinions.
Yep.
We have.
Absolutely.
Otherwise it would make us feel too uncomfortable to do otherwise.
Yeah. And I actually think one of the things that we know is that typically you will reshape the events of memories and the causes because you tend to think you did the best thing. And that's why if you ever talk to two people who have been in a fight and they haven't spoken at all since the fight, and they both think they're completely right. So I was also wanted to ask you about, so the reactivation of these images in Germany. And so of course you're gonna re-evoke them, could you also, I think, make people slightly more comfortable with those images and their history?
Make people more comfortable?
Yeah. Or is it, so do you think is the re-evocation of those images there to re-experience a certain context in time, or through reactivation, you can hypothetically reduce somebody's, trauma or experience of something bad by just adding something good to it. So for example, one of the ways in which PTSD was treated, 9/11, because I was here for 9/11, was that people would say, okay, remember the event, and then they would try to have some positive, something happy, after the re-evocation of the trauma. So every time you remember that, in that case, they were trying to reduce the trauma of it by just adding something less traumatic. So you can imagine, in this case, if you're calling something back up, that each time it's going to be restored, it's being restored with less salience or in different context now, then maybe it's some way to connect with the historical kind of narrative of that people.
Doesn't this beg the question about closure when we have, you know, all the psychologists who come and they have you relive your memories in order to achieve closure? Then, in fact, are they re-strengthening the actual memories that you don't want to keep?
Yeah. So, I mean, but a lot of these things, I think can happen depending on the situation. So memories, I mean, some memories you obviously want to keep. You know, memories can help us identify ourselves. And so there's some cool early studies showing that if you can't store down new memories, then you're stuck in the present. You can never move forward, right? And so that says how important memories are to us. But by the same token, under some conditions, they can be pathological. So if you are tied into the past and you can't go forward with PTSD, and that was like exactly what I thought of in your film. Everyone slows down emotionally, and then, but I guess in PTSD, they're kind of like stuck in the past and not quite slow down. So then when we're trying to target and block the PTSD reconsolidation, the people with whom it's been successful say it's allowed them to move forward. And which is, so I was hoping, I was wondering if in your presentation and the reenactment of other traumatic situations, maybe you could actually facilitate, help the emotional kind of tenor of that population to move forward in time.
Well, that was sort of the whole. I mean, you know, I should just back up and say because I'm a visual artist, and sort of come from the realm of sort of working with the imagination. Most artists were not that instrumental. Meaning, it's not like I come to a situation and have one specific goal, or intention in that way. I'm rather trying to create situations where will hopefully be evocative of various kinds of experiences for different people. But in terms of what you just mentioned, definitely that was part of the intention. Because it was such a short presentation, I couldn't really go into. I was playing off of Welsh iconic types.
Sure, of course.
The ex-coal miner, the minister, the male choir. In order, you know, what it was why can't this? Why isn't this village entitled to the same tropes or Welsh types as any other Welsh village?
Yeah.
So that was sort of part of where I was coming from.
Yeah.
But indeed, I. Well, if we had more, it was a very interesting project, but I feel a little bit the constraints of time, so as to not get in too much detail. But they were very, while I made the project with them, there was a film about the making of it, and a BBC film, a lot of this issue was that these issues were addressed in terms of how they felt participating, how they felt at the end, seeing the finished piece, etc.
Yeah.
But these are very interesting questions. I'm sort of, again, I sort of to both of you, but this issue of memory, a kind of a memorization, memory tools, memory signifiers, mnemonics, memory aids, I think to me it feels like a different kind of, more of a cognitive, not the body manifestation, but the mapping that goes on seems a bit more like a cognitive process, and I'm just sort of curious if for you, I was curious if the re-encoding neurochemically is different when, let's say, somebody has a memory of anxiety or sadness versus somebody who remembers a mathematical chart.
Yeah, good question. So at the biochemical level, the best guess right now is that it's all kind of the same, similar mechanisms, right? But not really the same kind of like psychological process. And so there are implications in terms of, say, reconsolidation, not just for traumatic memories, but for all kinds of memories. So if you imagine somebody who, for example, danced, and one of the first demonstrations of this reconsolidation process was in motor memories, right? So by Matthew Walker. So they learn a little motor sequence in their fingers, and then they show that memory, when it was reenacted, could go back to this reconsolidation stage along the same lines, possibly, of Pi. So, and the other thing I thought about Pi was I think people who have a certain excellence in terms of, say, athleticism in their sport, try to kind of get into a groove where their conscious memory gets out of the way.
Mm-hmm.
And so at least on the scientific side of things, people have reported that if you get rid in rodents of the part of the brain that does conscious thinking,
mm-hmm.
Then the rest of the body is better. at doing what they've got to do.
Yeah, we often call it flow.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
I kind of thought yeah. we might at some point get there, and perhaps she did.
Yeah.
To a certain extent, but the effect wasn't lasting.
Yeah. So, but I think, but that's interesting you said that, because the in rats, they have to do the same thing over and over again. So in order to hit the flow thing, you have to have a repeat that then you get into a groove, right? But so if pie and every single thing is different, then that will hold that up. Yeah.
Yeah, it's just too many different things lined up. And we kept increasing it, of course, as we went along.
Isn't there a point where, if I understood the process correctly, she learns a dance where the movements are they're keyed to different digits, and so it's almost like using pi as a choreographic sort of...
That was my original idea, that it would create choreography, but in the end, the choreography was completely secondary to the process of dealing with her memory.
Oh, interesting. Okay. That was sort of my question. There wasn't a point after which, like, let's say, having learned the pie dance, like a dancer having learned any dance, mm-hmm. at some point, you know, it just becomes kind of it becomes its own...
Well, you would know as an artist, you create rules and constraints, and then you decide, okay, when do I stick to the constraints or when do I break my own rules?
Yeah.
In this case, as we went on, you know, what I thought would happen kind of didn't happen. There are sections in it where she calls one section the ballet section and another section the turn section. So you'd think that they would have sort of stuck in some dance way for her, and yet... They really didn't. And yet, I can put on a piece of music that she danced to a year ago, and she will pick up phrases.
Wow.
That's interesting.
And has it enhanced her ability to pick up dancing, freestyle dancing, or not?
I don't know.
Mm-hmm. You think it might?
No, I don't, actually. This is a process we kind of go through anyway, but just not so rigorously. I mean, this is kind of ridiculous. Mm. Although, you know, you could think of somebody like Trisha Brown, who had set up all sorts of crazy mathematical processes for her dancers. She does these accumulations, and the movements are all different. Yvonne Rainer in Trio A does, it's just a string of movements, and they're not meant to have any sort of direct relationship with each other.
Mm-hmm.
And so typically, it's not far from what we would typically do. Mm.
It was so interesting watching it, because there were moments where I just loved watching the movement, and I almost didn't care where the actual art, okay, the dance. To me, it transcended the concept at times, and I love that when that happens. You know,
that's good by me.
Where I enjoyed the movement on its own, in and of itself.
Yeah, so. I would use it again. I mean, I use some mathematical tools to generate movement, and it was sort of a painful process, but it did produce something interesting and different. Yeah, mm-hmm. In dance, there are many people, especially in the field of ballet, who remember the steps to every single ballet they've ever performed, and you put on the music and they go through from the beginning to the end. And in a way, that's the only version of that music that they can feel or see or have in dance. And so, as somebody with I don't have that kind of memory, and in fact, when I recreate my own material, it's not in my memory physically or mentally, especially since I'm not performing it. I have to really look at it and think about the processes that were involved. So I like to think of it as in mathematics, where you have to devise the theorem. You don't just memorize the theorem. You devise it. You go through the whole process of proving it. And so with that in mind, you know, I'm wondering if it's possible that having an inaccurate memory or a poor memory, I'm not sure which I should say, would enhance or limit creativity?
Yeah, great question. I'm not sure. But
I'll let you give
your best guess first. Shimon.
No, it's kind of a profound question, because it touches on so many different on many, many different issues. You know, I guess the first question that would come to my mind is somebody's memory poor in an interesting way? You know, or is it sort of distorted in a way that's repetitive and compulsive and paranoid and you know?
That's a quality of it. Is it themselves or is it something like creative difference? Yeah, or like restrictive difference?
Well, yeah, exactly.
We always use these ideas of Mozart, who had this photographic memory, or he could remember a whole symphony and write it down. But it seems to me that could be a limitation on your creativity as well.
Yeah, one thing we know, and we've always known, I guess, is that our memories, and I love teaching this to students, because I say we've known that your memories are never remembered with accuracy. Every time you remember it, most people have the image of having a little snapshot of your memory of an event, and then it's stored in your brain, and then it's never like changed. And somebody, a very profound thinker of memory called Bartlett, in 1932, in a book called Remembering. So he was at Cambridge, and he showed that every time he had somebody recall an event or a narrative, they would kind of change the narrative in a way that was consistent with their beliefs of the world. And so they called it a schema, right? So it showed two things. It showed that memories are not just static entities in the world. And the second thing it showed was that memories will change over time in a way that will make most sense to your perspective of the universe, right? And so it's always funny because I ask students, look, I'm going to ask you, I'm on the exam, I'm going to ask you questions, even though I know that you may have studied for the answers, and the answers might have changed already by the time the exam comes, right?
Oh, I love it.
And so they don't laugh at that. They're still a bit pissed off at that.
That's perfect for me. I'm going to take the exam.
Right. Not to mention the questions, right?
Everything's changed.
That's the question.
So I think it's if the expectation is that memory should be constant, we've always known that's not the case. And it's also kind of an interesting thing. And it's not like a bad thing. Sometimes people say, well, is that going to change profoundly my identity? And some people like Dan Schachter at Harvard for the longest time have been saying, that's just like the way it's evolved, right? And part of the reason why we think the memory systems are not so concerned about getting every single bit of information accurate for long periods of time is that if you have more flexibility in the information, then he has a beautiful kind of story suggesting that what it allows you to do is it allows you to imagine many different possible futures, right? Mm-hmm. So if all your memories had the kind of neurobiology to be wired in there and never change, then you would not be able to imagine very many futures, right? So then with Pi, if you have, with that many dance steps, you want a memory system that's going to be very, very changeable and not so limited. Otherwise, it would become a bit just very tough. Obviously, yeah.
I mean, it brings up so many different questions. one question, of course, is the relationship between memory and learning, which is joined at the hip.
Yep.
And I still, just circle back to the fact that the kind of this sort of classical conditioning, I learned such and such, or I remember such and such, that when another event happens and they coincide in time, and that way I remember...
The salivating dogs.
Right.
The bells.
Which is a very sort of cognitive behavioral sort of approach to it. But there's so many different matrixes for different kinds of memory. And I feel like the cognitive learning one is experientially and phenomenologically pretty radically different than, let's say, a memory where you're flooded with emotion or sense, I'm just sort of
I agree.
Yeah.
Perhaps if we attached emotion to some of those memories, students seem to react best when there's some sort of emotive guidance from teachers.
Right.
They say who are your best teachers? They're never the ones who were boring. They're the ones who had some sort of
life
change in their emotions, enthusiasm, energy, something.
And we know that the emotions cause stress hormones to be released, and then that will enhance memory retention. And that is why we remember many things about, say, our birthdays. What happens, you know, if I ask you what happened on your birthday when you were 17, you probably remember more details than what happened like a few years ago on a day that was kind of boring. Right.
So are you saying?
They get the enhancement from the stress hormones. And so, yeah, that's completely consistent with what we think about the brain.
So are you saying that when I'm choreographing and I don't have a lot of time, I should get cakes with candles and get people
possibly
really excited, I mean, in the studio?
I'm not going on record for anything. That wouldn't be bad. Mm-hmm.
That wouldn't be
a bad thing.
You signaled that we need to wrap this part of it up shortly, but not to be a downer, but...
You don't like cake? You do like it. No,
I was being a little facetious when I said downer. But, you know, it's interesting having this conversation because we also have to recognize that it's occurring within a social context whereby, a moment in time whereby the whole phenomena of memory has become like a cottage industry. And, to the point of being fetishized or commodified in certain realms, like, you know, in the realm of monument and memorial making or other things. I think about things like what's the relationship of media and memory, how media actually, we get confused between things we've seen on television and things, and confuse them for our own memories, when in fact maybe we haven't experienced them, or spectacle and memory. There's public spectacle. And how that sort of influences our memories.
Yeah, there's the riots in London. I was just visiting a friend in Hackney, and she was talking about how where the second round of riots broke out.
Riots were these?
These were it started as a kind of a race riot, but it really became an opportunistic looting opportunity.
Sure, yeah.
And where that started was on this one block in this area of Hackney in London. And this person lived just on the next block, and she said there was nothing happening on her block. But because the media had taken this little section of area of where she lived, nearby where she lived, the whole world saw that the whole town was enveloped by this riot. And now that's the experience of the people in the town, is that they think that their whole town was taken over by this rioting. And in fact, it was only a very small area. It did, though, inflame other areas in South London afterwards.
And that, I think, is a perfect example of how memories can change according to your environment and your beliefs, right?
I'd love to open it up to questions from the audience. But before I do, selfishly, since I have the microphone, I just had a question for the three of you. You mentioned a favorite memory that was formed when a lot of emotion was present, like your 17th birthday. But in remembering it over and over again, it seems like every time you remember this memory, it's likely to change, right? So in some ways, our most precious memories are incredibly vulnerable. And I feel like, I wonder if there's a connection with the visual arts, like a worn photograph that we look at over and over again. Does it lose meaning or gain meaning? A dance that you performed countless times, does it? So I was just curious if there was like an artistic equivalent to this memory cycle.
Mm-hmm.
Well, certainly with dances, they change over time. But it's partly, if we're talking about my own work, it's partly because I want them to change over time. That is, I want the dancers to do it as though it's the sort of the first time they've done it, rather than repeating the dance that they did last night. So I suppose in a way, the integrity is in some big ideas connected with the dance and not in the rote memory of all of the details. So I suspect in that case it does change. But I'm sure that the dances change over time. If you do Nutcracker, your memory of it, your experience of it, what you think it is, the value of it. But I don't know if that's because you're tired of doing it. So.
For me as a visual artist, it's a difficult question to respond to, partly because I think
one of the biggest challenges we as artists face is, at least in my mind, is trying to create works of art that are complex and don't give everything away on the first viewing, so that you come back to it again and again. If it's a strong piece, and have a different experience each time, or see something that you didn't see before, or feel something that you didn't feel before. Otherwise, it's kind of, it has a danger of being sort of didactic or reductive, like a one-liner, right? Like one-liner art. So it's difficult for me to respond because I think that's an overarching challenge. Yeah. The issue of memory is only a subset of that. Hopefully it should be the gift that keeps on giving,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah, and in dance from the viewer's experience, I know that different times of day, different times of a person's life, the experience is very different, even though it is the same dance. They'll remember it differently. They'll have it. Yeah, it's just not. Yeah.
And also the just point one of the ways in which we can protect, or the brain protects from the change in content, is that in some conditions memories will not undergo reconsolidation. So sometimes if a memory is very robust, it won't, right? Sometimes if there's too many repetitions of it, then it will not. So perhaps that's just nature's way of preventing things that are dear and close to us, like you said, from being modified in a way that might threaten its kind of content. But again, the other thing we should also just keep in mind is that I think there's probably a limit to how much you can change, memories can change. So I'm not sure whether if you said you were abducted by 18 aliens yesterday, whether that, just too much maybe to do all at once, right? But obviously, people like Elizabeth Loftus has shown that, it's amazing what you can have people think happen to them over a longer period of time.
Thank you. Hi, I just want to say, Mr. Nader, I'm a huge fan of your work. And
thank you very much.
As an artist and curator, it's had a very strong, direct effect on my practice. So I want to thank you for that.
Thank you very much.
I work from memory, and some distant memory and some more recent. And I found that some of the more distant memories that I have, like maybe from when I was 15, I'll have maybe 3 or 4 memories from that time in my life. And but those memories hold much more information, like a conduit for. And so this specificity of the memory ends up communicating a lot to me about my own story. What I found so interesting, like let's say working in sculpture, recreating a memory, is that the way that I would, the own memory, the way that I would reform it over and over again, it ends up being the same way that an artist would work. So that, let's say I have a memory of my mother from a certain period of my life, and she was upset with me about something. And the exact positioning, or even her rhythm, in the way that she, or her cadence, or however she was communicating to me at that moment in that memory, is a way of telling me something very specific about my relationship with her at that period of my life, so that I can have some kind of continuation in my own narrative. So I'm wondering, is there a way in which we are always acting as artists with our sensory imprint of a memory and constantly recrafting it so that we can have a sense of meaning and narrative? And can more collaborations come from that using what we know about neuroscience and contemporary art?
So certainly, I mean, on a day-to-day basis, at least from the memory side, Bartlett would say every time you remember an event, it's your mother, then you can. I mean, it's not challenging the continuity of that of the perception, but it just allows you to interact with it and perhaps update it in some manner. And if it is, if it doesn't require perhaps updating, then that's fine. And you would just do justice to that memory. But with visual art, I think that would be another way in which you can possibly do some of the people's narratives, whether it's a person's narrative or a cultural the narrative of a culture. I think that's what I was impressed by with Shimon's images, because this is like the culture of, like, you know, in Germany, and it just I guess it's one of the, what was it, ghettos, I guess, in German. And so by re-evoking that, you could in some ways hypothetically call up a certain kind of meaning for that time period and change that meaning, if that was the way in which you were predisposed.
But I wonder, what's your name?
Ryan.
I wonder if you're asking, because it's an interesting question, but I think there's a deeper kernel to it that maybe we're not getting at, which is, you said greater collaboration between visual, for example, between visual art or visual artists and, let's say, neuroscientists?
Yeah, because, I mean, what we know now, if you were to re-access
yes.
memory, just
oh, I see,
memory
yep.
to an artist, given that you have the relationship, or that you learned about the talent they use, or the
oh, I see, yeah.
you can re-access clearly, provably didn't have when you experienced that memory. So you would, in effect, be recrafting your memory with the new medium. So isn't there, I'm saying, isn't that, in that kind of recurrence with the new visualization?
Yeah. Myriad possibilities.
Yeah.
It sounds like you're already collaborating with yourself, though. And
yeah.
I mean, I don't believe his personality is a fixed thing. So it would seem like your palette shifts over time as well, and that your memories then change over time because your palette also shifts. So that it seems to me that there are, you know, it's a dual-layered sort of collaboration with yourself, with someone else.
Yeah, 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 I agree. Yeah. So, hang on, a quick question. So, hands up, how many people have seen The Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind?
I watched it last night.
So, this is one time when I say science is better than fiction and art, because on the artistic side of that, the implication was that you could, if you erase a memory altogether, in this case, the person's breakup with his girlfriend, then, and so what they did was, in the movie, erased the entire memory, and it showed the implications of what happens if you get rid of the entire memory. And it's never kind of ideal. I mean, even if you had a magic wand, if a scientist had a magic wand, you could do that. Maybe it's not so ideal, right? Especially for people who have had PTSD for, say, decades, because they try to, I mean, they identify with being PTSD, they try to move on, to move through time. So the treatment that we thought of, and specifically with the intent of trying to do slightly better than the science fiction film, and there's no genius involved. It was just based on taking what we knew about how the brain is organized and works, and just applying it. And what we know about the brain is that there are different memory systems in the brain, and we've known that for decades. And so if you have trauma, the pain and loathing and the fear and loathing of the event is kind of stored in one part of the brain called the amygdala, and the conscious part of that event is stored in another structure and systems, of course, just called the hippocampus, I just said. And so then what we did was we thought, okay, so if you just block reconsolidation of the emotional value of the trauma, and you use manipulation that would spare the conscious memories, which are also undergoing reconsolidation, then, which is what we did, then the prediction was that you should still be able to remember the trauma, the patients, but they should not be stuck in the past. So they should be able to move forward and move on with their life. And that's what essentially we found. And so people, women who, you know, had been raped decades ago, could talk about their trauma for the first time after decades.
Yeah. I was in India this year, and I was flying on an airplane, and the man who leads all of the neuro-linguistic programming, this NLP course, in all of India, was sitting next to me on the plane. Mm-hmm. And he, of course, he was trying to sell me on taking his course. And I'm a skeptic, and oh, I don't believe in any of this. I teach yoga, I meditate, da da da. Anyway, he tells me that if you have trauma or something that's happened to you in your life and you have a phobia about it, that there's an actual way that you can brainwash somebody by making them remember this traumatic memory or this phobia, bring them there, and then you start to have them go backwards, playing like loud carnival music and crazy, you know, da, 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 da. And then you bring them back to the memory, and then they go backwards, da, 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 and then you bring them back, and then their phobia is gone. I said,
wow.
Oh, really? This really works, because apparently this loud carnival music is destroying neural pathways in their memory.
I've been in India for about 6 months and lost most of my pathways there. It's pretty loud.
There's a correlation between India. This is NLPs all over the world. But do you believe in this? I thought it was kind of.
It's always for scientists, an empirical question. So, I mean, in a study, I mean, will it show better than like a placebo? So I don't know whether I don't know enough about it. I mean, the day after we published the initial Nature paper showing that memories can be kind of theoretically unstored and can be erased, the group from the I can't remember this. One treatment is if you have desensitization, eye movement desensitization, I think. Yeah, that's it. There's a certain kind of treatment that suggests that if you have somebody recall the trauma and then you do a certain manipulation, visual manipulation, then they have reported that it can improve somebody's traumatic experience pretty rapidly.
Like the EMDR?
Yes, that's EMDR.
Right.
So the time course was kind of consistent with reconsolidation blockade. It's still, I think, an open question as to whether the treatment is as effective as other treatments and how reliable. So it's still, I think, an open question. I think. I might get in trouble for saying that.
It's interesting, though, because you were saying dancers use music to help remember. So
you talk about memory in a way which it seems to reinforce a sense of self-esteem. So memory is inherently flawed, so that we can have a better
understanding. Speak just a little louder.
So that we can have an understanding of the self in a positive way. Like you're talking about people getting into fights and each individual always thinks that they're right. And I wonder how this this natural buffer, which you've sort of elaborated on in a way which can erase and alter memories, how this pertains to the artistic practice and if it's beneficial in any way or negative. Because I know that trauma can incite a lot of artistic practices and that it can benefit art in many ways. So I wonder how altering memory affects art, if that makes any sense.
So I would like to know whether anyone, is there any data that trauma makes art better or is better inspire?
I was listening to every word and still can you reduce it, the question, to something a little more condensed? Try to make, because it's
a question, more so that I want to hear you talk about it.
Go on. On the issue of how trauma.
Give me 1 second. I'm going to put it into my head. How our natural ability to alter memory, to preserve self-esteem, could help art and how it could be affected negatively, possibly, or how it could be affected positively by altering memories and therapy like that.
I think that some of the artistic process is simply that, is, you know, some people make a dance, they make the same dance over and over and over again, but with some changes along the way, as though they're trying to, I don't know, either remember something or perfect some memory. Maybe that's sort of the opposite of what you're saying, in that they're trying to zoom in on some particular idea that exists in them that they have in their mind. I don't know if that's directly an issue about memory. I mean, I suppose in a way I think it is. I wonder if it goes the other way then, that you, I don't know if I have a response to that one.
You know, it's a challenging question to address, partly because, you know, for starters, of course, memories. I mean, the example you gave, right, of how memory can be a self-esteem buffer or booster, is, you know, I wish it was always like that, but you know, that's sort of one color out of the rainbow. You know, it can be a self-esteem destroyer. It can be a, you know, it can be many, many different things. You know, you can have chronically low self-esteem because of the nature of the memories that you have. But in terms of visual art, artistic practice more generally, a lot of what we're working with is narrativity, creating narratives. And whether it's kind of a complex narrative, whether it's a multi-layered narrative, whether it's a narrative that undermines itself, et cetera. But how we tell, in other words, telling a story, right? If I was a documentary filmmaker, which I'm not, you know, we talk about telling a story. But I think that the issue of, it's impossible to separate those two things out, memory and the telling of stories, right? Because it's a temporal medium, past, present, future. You can't tell a story with by definition without creating memories each step along the way. So I think it has all kinds of potential in a number of different directions. I don't think I can answer it better than that because it's
It actually is an interesting question. I think, you know, when I'm listening to all of the conversation and the questions, personally, I feel that nothing about me is fixed. And so, you know, when we talk about memory, I've never really felt like I had a memory that was true or even repeated in the same way over time. So I think for me the discussions seem to have a question about what is fixed when we talk about palettes and things like that. Like, are there things that are fixed, or is everything fluid and in flux? And of course, then we can all scream and run and say the world is coming to an end, which it is on the 21st. So
I want to know how you relate all of this, especially to jazz music, because with jazz you have highly sophisticated chords that are this mathematical set of equations, and at the same time you have, and you must memorize that, yet at the same time you're supposed to improvise and take those somewhere new at every second that you go through it. So I just want to know how that relates, or how you think about it.
Well, that's interesting, because I love working while I'm listening to jazz music. I find it frees me up, and I think there is something about that combination between it, that there is a systematic structure, even if it sort of evolves and changes over time, but combined with this sort of the free-flowing improvisational elements. And for me personally, it's my favorite music to have on when I'm working. No, I do. I mean, it's very, you know, memory is very important to me. I mean, it's been my, you know, as an artist, it's been my subject matter for a really long time. Some of it's very just a question of temperament. You know, I'm somebody who, I'm not very good at making a separation between past, present, and future. I always feel like the past is always here in the texture of today, and the texture of my life. You know, for better or for worse. Sometimes I wish I was better at making that separation. But so no, it's something that I sort of think a lot about every day, essentially, or experience some aspect of it every day.
I think I'm very much in the jazz mode. this consolidation that was being discussed, I think jazz is a perfect example of where you've consolidated memory of the techniques. But you know, we do that in dance too, although it's maybe slightly, you know, it may seem less complex. But I just have to contrast.
Please.
I past, present, future. I don't. For me, I'm kind of the opposite extreme, and partly the reason, of course, that I asked the question about creativity and memory is that I regularly remind myself I'm creating memories, that the fact that I don't memorize things well or that they don't stay with me over time enhances my ability to choreograph new and imaginative works because I'm not relying on what I made last year. So it was a little selfish question there.
Thank you, and please help me in thanking our speakers one last time.